Welcome to Slow Dancing with Romans. We are beginning a new chapter in Romans tonight, Romans chapter 4. So looking forward to spending these next few minutes with you. But let's pray and just to begin as we come to the Word, prepare our hearts. Lord, we need you to understand your Word. We are dependent upon you in everything we do. And especially, Lord, as we come to your inspired word and want to be changed and transformed as you reveal to us who you are and your ways and how you work and how you have worked through Christ and for us and what it means to be in relationship with you. Would you please just encourage and edify our hearts this evening? And would you allow us to walk in a manner worthy of the gospel as we are transformed by your word and by the verses that we'll be looking at this evening? We just pray that you would move by your Spirit in us. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ I pray. Amen. All right, so we are jumping into Romans chapter 4. And we just came through the end of 3, where last week we talked, or 2 weeks ago, we talked about chapter 3, 27 through 31. And so just to kind of give us the context here, that section really emphasized 2 points, and it was that God is the God of Jews and Gentiles. There is no ethnocentrism, that there is that God's people are all nations, tribes, languages, and tongues, and God is the God of Jews and Gentiles, which is really the two groupings of the Roman community that needed to be working towards reconciliation. It's a constant theme throughout the book of Romans. And then secondly, God's justification by faith applies to both the circumcised and uncircumcised. This practice of circumcision became an identity marker for Jews, and it really became not only am I a part of the people of God, but how can I remain and stay a part of the people of God? And that is through the practices of the law. And so Paul's fleshing this out, and he's saying, look, our justification by faith is no longer dependent upon obedience to the law of Moses, that justification comes by faith. And actually now he's going to show that actually it's always kind of been this way. But here's what N.T. Wright kind of summarizes the chapter is saying. He says, the chapter is an exposition of the covenant that God made with Abraham in Genesis 15, showing at every point how God always intended and promised that covenant would include Gentiles as well as Jews. So the point that Paul's making is, yes, Abraham is going to be the kind of picture of faith and of what justification looks like by faith. He's going to be the example that Paul's going to pull out from the Old Testament. But he's also going to be the kind of the final point that he's making is it's always been a part of God's plan to include the Gentiles in the people of God, that God's heart has always been for the nations. And we're seeing this played out now in more beauty through the work of Jesus Christ. So let's read Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. What then shall we say was gained by Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness, just as David also speaks of the blessing of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. All right, so two sections really here, verses 1 through 3 and 4 through 8 that we're going to break down. And first, Paul is going, he's been talking about Jews and Gentiles. He's talking about justification by faith. And he's talking about the law now. And he's kind of saying how we're saved by faith and not by works of the law. And so then he's going to go to Abraham, and he's going to use Abraham as an example. And the question is why, right? Why would Paul move to Abraham as a case in point example of his argument that he's making? Why would this apply, and how did the Jews think about Abraham at the time? Those are important questions to know as we come to this text. And I just want to read you, I found these quotes in one of the commentators pulled them out from a bunch of rabbinic writings and teachings from that day. And here's what certain rabbis were teaching about Abraham. One says, Abraham was perfect in all his deeds with the Lord and well-pleasing in righteousness all the days of his life. One said, Abraham did not sin against thee. Another one, no one has been found like him in glory. All right, so the attitude of the Jews to Abraham was that he was like this lifted up character who really was beyond any kind of discrepancy or sin even. Some even went so far as to say that he was perfect and of a higher glory than anyone else. And so Paul, when he pulls out Abraham, he knows that he's using as an example the guy that all the Jews looked to as their father Abraham, and that was kind of beyond sin even. So they're really kind of, he's pulling out the highest picture, highest example he could find. And so Paul's going, but what he's going to do is he's going to directly contrast certain rabbinic thoughts. People were, if you think Abraham's perfect, and then you think, oh, so God chooses Abraham and Israel comes from Abraham because Abraham was perfect, you start to think that Abraham earned this place, right? You start to think that Abraham merited this relationship with God. And Paul's going to show that that is not the case. Here's verses 1-3. He says, what then shall we say was gained by Abraham, our forefather, according to flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, like the Jews were saying, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. So the points that Paul's making here is that Abraham cannot boast before God because of works. Paul clearly says it. He might have something to boast about if he were, but he wasn't. He says, but not before God. That little phrase at the end there, he's saying no one can boast about their works before God. I mean, he's holy and perfect and righteous, and no one comes to that level of glory, even Abraham. And then Paul says, so what did happen with Abraham? And Abraham, it says, believed God, quoting Genesis 15, verse 6. Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. This belief in God was the saving faith. And Tim Keller describes saving faith in this way. He says, saving faith is a trust transfer. We've already kind of talked about this as we've talked about faith in chapter 3. And so this is kind of reviewing some of the points that Paul was making about faith in Romans 3. But here's what he says. Saving faith is a trust transfer. Saving faith is not believing that God is there. Further, it is not believing in a God who saves. It is believing God when he promises a way of salvation by grace. Okay, that salvation by grace is a key factor in saving faith, in true belief. If we believe in God who saves us as we kind of bring some works to the table to earn something, then we're not having true faith, because the core of our salvation is that it is by grace, which is what he's going to continue to emphasize. Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now, this language is kind of unique. What does it mean for something to be counted as righteousness? There's different ways of translating this. Could be counted to him, reckoning, crediting. But here's what it means. It means to account to him a righteousness that does not inherently belong to him. So Abraham wasn't inherently righteous, but God is counting him as righteous. And it's not inherent to him. It's actually what we're going to see in a second. It's a gift of God's grace. It's a declaration of, I will accept you, Abraham, not because of anything you've done, not because of anything that you have earned, but because by my grace, I am accepting you as my man to begin this journey of redemption. And Abraham believed God. And he responded in faith to that offer of salvation by grace. And so Paul's going to continue to flesh this point out. He goes into verse 4 now. He says, now to the one who works, and he's using more examples here to flesh out this point. Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Just as David also speaks, and we'll get to David in a second. But what is he making here in verses 4-5? What points is he making? He's first of all making a comparison between wages and a gift, right? If you have worked for, if you worked for me, I had you do some landscaping. I had to pay my son today an allowance because he mowed the grass today. He did a really good job. I was impressed. And so he mowed the grass, and Maria said she was going to give him some allowance for it. And so, even though I disagreed, I was like, no, he lives in our house. He should be mowing the grass. But, you know, she'd already promised it. So what are you going to do? I'm giving him money. I did not say to Josiah, technically I could have because. Yeah, anyway, but I did not say to Josiah, this is a gift. Here you go. I just felt like giving you this money. No, in one sense, he earned it, right? He was told, if you do this work, you'll get paid this much. And then, so I gave him the money that he had earned because he did the work. That was not a gift. That was a wage. That was a payment. And Paul's making this point. He's saying, we did not do anything to earn this salvation. It's not a wage that God owes us. It's a complete gift. And this is a huge point. And Douglas Moo says that God acts towards his creatures graciously without compulsion or necessity is one of Paul's non-negotiable theological axioms. All right. The fact that God, without any outside compulsory or necessary reason, he chooses by his own superabundant grace to give us the gift of salvation. And so Paul's making in verse 4 this point that Tim Keller fleshes out. Our righteousness is an either or. Either it is merited by our works or it is credited without regard for them. You cannot have both. Paul is making an extreme contrast between the two. He's going directly against some Judaistic thinking and teaching in that day. Verse 5. He talks about the differences between a work and a belief. And actually, verse 5 has even been called the core summary of the gospel by some. But what he says in verse 5 is this, and I have it underlined actually, and to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Now, how is Paul using the word work here? Why? Because obviously we know James is going to come down later and say faith without works is dead. And even Paul has no concept of a kind of I'm saved by grace and now I can do whatever I want. He's going to clearly say that's wrong when we get to Romans chapter 6. And so the question is, what does Paul mean when he's using the word work? And here I think Michael Bird explains it well. He says by works, Paul means performance of the Jewish law that satisfies alleged criteria for entrance into the people of God who will be saved at the final day. So when Paul's using works, when he says to the one who does not work, he's talking about a work that is a obedience to the law with an expectation that this obedience is going to earn me a good judgment on the final day. And that kind of hope is a false hope because none of us are saved by works. It's only by grace and by grace alone. And so then to kind of give a final kind of knockout punch point on this one, he quotes David back in Psalm 32, where David's talking about the blessing of God's forgiveness. And look at the language that David uses. He says, blessed are those whose lawless deeds, so these are wrong deeds, but they're forgiven, and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. So it's not just that God is counting Abraham's belief as righteousness. He's not counting against him the sin that Abraham was living in and everyone else who believes in him. And that's what Douglas Moo says here. He says, it is not the reckoning of people's good works, but God's act in not reckoning their sins against them that constitutes forgiveness. And so here's the really, really good news for you and me. We are not saved by our works. And that is huge, because if it was dependent upon our works or obedience to the law or to laws in general, we would all fall short. Paul's already made this point in Romans 3:23. We all fall short of the glory of God. Our only hope is a gracious God. Our only hope is a work of complete gift that is strong enough to save us. And that gift is Jesus Christ. Grace is a Christ gift. Grace is not some abstract kind of theological concept. It's really tied to the person of Jesus Christ and his work for us. When we talk about the gift of grace, we're talking about the gift of Christ and his sacrifice on the cross and his death for our sins and his resurrection and all that he has won for us in him. Because our faith unites us to Christ. And so because we're united to Christ, we receive righteousness and justification and adoption and all these realities because we've been incorporated into Christ. And so that is the good news of Jesus Christ. And Paul's just getting his argument going here with Abraham, and we're only going to go this far tonight, but it is hugely important to recognize that we are not saved by our works, but by grace alone. And here's where it gets really practical. And I just have this in the last section here, truth for life. Or we need to ask ourselves, where have we placed our trust? Have we put all of our trust in the gift of grace, not the works of men or women or ourselves? And here, you'll remember that you'll probably, if you grew up in the Christian culture, you'll be familiar with evangelism explosion, which is kind of a way of talking to people about Christ and calling them to repentance and faith in Jesus. I did it when I was in middle school, actually. But here's one of the questions that you start with in that. And it goes like this. Suppose that you were to die tonight and stand before God, and he were to say to you, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say? That's a classic kind of American Christian evangelism tactic. Or question. And Tim Keller puts it another way. He says, another version of the question would be, assuming for the moment that there really is a heaven, what do you think are the general requirements for admission? Who gets in and who doesn't? Okay, so, and he says this, continuing to quote Tim Keller, anyone who asks one of these questions to a random sample of church-going people, he's talking about church-going people here, or you could just say Bible Belt Christians. He says, anyone who asks one of these questions to a random sample of church-going people will be surprised at the large number who say one of these. A, because I have tried my best to be a good Christian. B, because I believe in God and try to do his will. And 3, because I believe in God with all my heart. If God were to say, why should I let you into heaven? So many in our culture, in our world, and especially in our county here near Savannah, would say, I've tried to be a good Christian. Some would say, I believe in God and I try to do his will. Some say, I believe in God with all my heart. And he goes on to say, this is not a trick question. It reveals common misconceptions about what it means to believe, to have faith. Answer A is a salvation by works answer. If you think you're getting in because you've tried to be a good Christian, you are believing in a salvation by works, and not a faith that saves. Answer B is a salvation by faith plus works. Right? I believe in God and I try to do his will because I just need to make sure I'm going to get in. And then answer C is a salvation by faith as a work. So a lot of times what happens is people put their faith in the fact that they believe. Like, I'm saved because I prayed a prayer when I was a child. And we kind of can make these kind of things that are interwoven with faith in believing it's a work itself, that by the work of my faith, I have earned salvation. and that would be to go askew. He says, in each case, the person is religious, but is not someone who does not work. in there, he's quoting verse 5, where Paul says, and to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteous. Like, we are in the category of those who do not work, who did not earn anything. We bring nothing to the table. We've only received all that Christ has offered, and we believe that it's true. We believe that it's good. We believe that it's real, and we trust in his work and his work alone. And he says, in the last case, the person has even come to trust in his or her trust. So often we can turn even our religious ideas and beliefs into a kind of work that earns us something from the Lord. And so the question is, have we done a real trust transfer? Are we okay with being a people who do not work for our salvation? It's called in Corinthians, it's called foolishness to the Greeks and a stumbling block to the Jews. There are some who do not want to receive a gift of grace. They want to earn things. They don't like the idea that they can't do anything, that they can't earn anything. That is an affront against pride and self-righteousness. But we are a people who do not work. We do not obey the laws so that we can earn anything. We simply receive what Christ offers by grace alone. And that's the good news of the gospel.